इंट्रोस्पेक्टिव
हरे कृष्णा आई थिंक शी गॉट ड्रॉप्ड कैन समवन कंटिन्यू रीडिंग द पर्पट
Can I do it?
Yes, please.
Yeah, there are two classes of intelligent men. One is intelligent in material activities for sense gratification, and the other is introspective and awake to the cultivation of self-realization. Activities of the introspective sage or thoughtful man or knight for persons materially absorbed. Materialistic persons remain asleep in such a night due to their ignorance of self-realization. The introspective sage remains alert in the night of the materialistic man. The sage feels transcendental pleasure in the gradual advancement of spiritual culture, whereas the man in the materialistic activities, being asleep to self-realization, dreams of varieties of sense pleasure, feeling sometimes happy and sometimes distressed in a sleeping condition. The introspective man is always indifferent to materialistic happiness and distress. He goes on with his self-realization activities undisturbed by material reactions.
Right. So I think we can understand how in a straightforward sense, in a very, very literal meaning of this shloka, if we take what is night for all beings is a time of awakening to the self-control, and the time of awakening for all beings is a night for the introspective sage. So even if we take the very literal meaning, we understand that how people who are trying to cultivate spirituality, they get up very really early in the morning.
कधी घेऊन जायचंय तुला?
या पार्थ प्रिया प्रभू, डिड आय मेक यू द को होस्ट?
येस प्रिया, आय विल टेक केअर, थँक यू.
आय वॉज जस्ट वॉन्टिंग इफ आय गिव यू द राइट्स. ओके, सो या सो समबडी हू इज ट्राइंग, हू इज कल्टिवेटिंग स्पिरिच्युअलिटी, ही गेट्स अप रियली अर्ली. We typically have the time of Brahma Murta, and Parthapriya Prabhu was also taking a session around 6 o'clock every morning where, most of you all are coming and joining and chanting, right? So somebody who's really serious for spiritual life, right? And this is one of the statements of Srila Prabhupada, somebody who cannot get up early in the morning is not really serious for spiritual life, right? So somebody who's really serious for spiritual life will get up really early, and typically before sunrise. He can get up and perform spiritual activities, because that is a time, this Brahma Murta is generally 1.5 hours before sunrise, so that is the time where the external disturbances are minimum, right? You don't have somebody calling you at that time, or you don't have your family members or relatives demanding things from you.
That 3:30 to 5 Brahma Murta.
Yes, Mataji.
3:30 to 5 Brahma Murta.
Yeah, so that's not a fixed time as such. It's 1.5 hours before sunrise. Close to that, around 4:30 is where the Brahma Murta starts. So a self-realized or somebody who's striving for self-realization generally gets up during that time. Because that is the time where, the capacity of the mind to absorb things is very, very high. It's even scientifically proven that that is a time which is very conducive to learn something or to read or to meditate, right? So somebody who's serious takes advantage of this particular time, right? Whereas on the other side, on the flip side of things, we see somebody who's completely absorbed in materialistic ways of life, they would party and come home at 3 o'clock probably or 4 o'clock, and they would actually go to sleep at that time, when the introspective stage is actually getting up, rising up and engaging in devotional activities. The other aspect of what Prabhupada is describing here is that the sage feels transcendental pleasure in gradual advancement of spiritual culture, whereas a man in materialistic activities, being asleep to self-realization, dreams of varieties of sense pleasure, feeling sometimes happy and sometimes distressed. So, typically what is, really exciting to, people in general, an introspective sage is asleep, practically asleep to something like that, right? He doesn't feel interested. Sorry? Somebody saying something? Okay. Yeah, so, the sage is actually, just like we saw the shloka where, Krishna is describing how a person who's on the path of self-realization, he withdraws his senses just like a tortoise, right? He withdraws his senses when there is opportunity for self-gratification, which means he doesn't engage in sense gratification. And when it comes to actually serving the Lord, he manifests his senses again and, utilizes them fully, even more than the materialistic man. Srila Prabhupada, when he was, preparing, or rather when he was doing the activities trying to print the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, right? So he was, running back and forth, traveling, meeting, businessmen and other people to collect some funds, going to the printing house, purchasing paper, going to the printer, proofreading things himself. He was so busy that even a businessman would fail in front of him. So much like how a businessman is in anxiety, to get things done so that his business can really expand. Similarly, Prabhupada was, more than a regular businessman, he was absorbed and engaged like that. And Prabhupada writes that, somebody, seeing him would feel that he is also engaged in all materialistic activities, but that is actually for service of the Lord. So a devotee, he engages all his senses, more than even the materialist when it comes to serving the Lord, right? He's even more active. Whereas that is something which is almost like night to the materialistic people. They don't care about, spiritual activities. Whenever you invite people, the, simple response will be, I don't have time, right? Or I'm not interested. It's almost like they're asleep or indifferent to spiritual activities, right? And similarly is the case for the self-realized sage or, somebody who's trying to advance in spiritual life, right? So one of the principles of surrender is to accept the favorable and reject the unfavorable, right? What is that shloka, Prabhu? I forgot. Accepting the favorable, rejecting the unfavorable, I forgot the Sanskrit. Prabhuji, you remember? Anukulena Krishna Anushilanam Avasarini, but Anukulena.
Anukulena.
So there are six principles of surrender, right? So one of the initial ones is Anukulasya Sankalpa, which means that you accept whatever is favorable for Krishna consciousness, which is the practice of rising early, associating with devotees, right? And chanting in association of devotees like in the morning. So that these are some things which are very, very favorable for our Krishna consciousness, which gives us enthusiasm to perform devotional activities. Of course, when you try to do it alone, you have to do alone for quite a long time as well. But if there is someone who's also doing, right, you get, certain, you become more enthusiastic. So these are some favorable things for devotional service. So the first principle of surrender, right? Krishna says, surrender unto me, right? He's demanding surrender, right? So one of the first principles of surrender is to accept whatever is favorable for Krishna consciousness and reject whatever is unfavorable, right? Like, the four regulative principles, no meat eating, no intoxication, no gambling, no illicit sex. These are poison for our spiritual life, literally poison, right? So, therefore, one of the first things that we do is do's and don'ts, right? Even in the practice of yoga, right, we start with yam and niyam, do's and don'ts, right? So this is the first step of surrender to Krishna, accepting the favorable, rejecting the unfavorable, right? It goes on, six steps. So Rakshasi iti Vishwaso, that we have firm faith that Krishna is our only protector. And then depending on the Lord, right, that he is the maintainer. Then there is, I think, humility. And what is the one more? Partha Priya Prabhu, you remember? There's one more, I forgot. So depending on the Lord.
Protection.
Depending on the protection of the Lord. Like Krishna, will, no matter what, Krishna will protect. Avashya, what is that? Avashya Rakshibe Krishna. Right. So having full faith that no matter what, Krishna will protect. Right. And then humility. Right. So these are six principles of surrender. So, yeah. So an introspective stage, you know, he accepts all things that are favorable, and he rejects naturally, you know, the materialistic things, which people in general are interested. It's their daytime. So for the sage, it's night. He's sleeping when the materialists are trying to enjoy, right? All different kinds of things. Similarly, the materialists are sleeping when the sage is actually experiencing unlimited transcendental pleasure in performing activities in Krishna consciousness. Prabhuji, you want to add something?
To add to your point, you mentioning about how materialistic people think. So Prabhupada says in the lecture that so when the materialistic people, they see, you know, the spiritualists, like they might be seeing them chanting Hare Krishna and spending their day in spiritual activities. For them, it's like, you know, why are you wasting time? You know, do something, get a life. For them, it's kind of like that. You know, when they think that, array, you are so qualified, you are educated, you are this, you are that. You know, why are you wasting your life, you know, doing this Hare Krishna all the time? So materialistic people think like that. And on the other hand, the devotees or the spiritualists who are there, they think that, you know, okay, you have a good job, you have good position. Next what? What will happen after that? What's next? What's next? You know, because there are so many plans people make. We want to travel abroad. We want a big post. We want this. We want that. Okay, what next? What next? And Prabhupada says at the time of death, everything will be taken away. Then what? So that is how a spiritualist thinks. He is introspective. He is thinking not just of the immediate future, but even the future that is beyond this life. So that is how, you know, it's night. You know, for what is night for the spiritualist is day for the materialist, and vice versa.
Yeah. In fact, thank you for sharing this. It reminded me that how so many of, you know, these ISKCON devotees, they face this during, you know, book distribution marathon, particularly when actually devotees go out on the street and distribute books. Young boys, you know, particularly, you know, we are from ISKCON Youth Forum. So, you know, so many boys are there, and, you know, we would go out on, you know, distributing books. A lot of people sometimes would say, are you not getting a job? You know, you're doing this, selling Bhagavad Gita on streets, right? You know, some people accuse, are Bhagavad Gita ko tum sadak pe le aaye, right? So they don't understand that since you're not taking advantage, so we have to come out and, you know, give it to you. It's actually mercy of Bhagavad Gita that it's actually trying to come out and, you know, reach out to you. Since you're not reaching out, that's one. And second, you know, people, when they say, yo, you don't have a job, you know, why you're doing this? So there are so many times people, devotees, they're from IITs and some other places, they say, oh, we have a very well-paying job. Or actually, I left a job which is paying me so many lakhs and crores of rupees, but I'm doing this because this is the real thing to do. And you should also start doing it. And they're impressed. They're suddenly like, you know, okay, I thought you don't have a job, therefore you're doing this. So, yeah. This has been, you know, quite a few experiences like that. All right. Let's go to the next one.
Krishna Prabhuji, sorry, I pressed wrong button and I left the...
Yeah, no worries. No worries. Any thoughts on what we just... Any pointers anyone would like to share? Any realizations or... Should we move ahead?
Yes.
Apuryamanam achala pratishtham.
Apuryamanam achala pratishtham.
समुद्रम आप प्रविशन्ति यद्वत्
समुद्रम आप प्रविशन्ति यद्वत्
कामा यम प्रविशन्ति सर्वे शांति माप्नोति न काम कामी
शांति माप्नोति न काम कामी
I would like to read the translation.
Can I read, sir?
Yes, please.
A person who is not disturbed by the incessant flow of desires that enters like rivers into the ocean, which is ever being filled, but is always still, can alone achieve peace, and not the man who strives to satisfy such desires.
So, yeah. Let me first.
Can I also read the purport?
Yes, Prabhuji, I think go ahead. Okay.
Although the vast ocean is always filled with water, it is always, specifically during the rainy season, being filled with much more water. But the ocean remains the same, steady. It is not agitated, nor does it cross beyond the limit of its brink. That is also true of a person fixed in Krishna consciousness. As long as one has the material body, the demands of the body for sense gratification will continue. The devotee, however, is not disturbed by such desires. Because of his fullness, Krishna conscious man is not in need of anything, because the Lord fulfills all his material necessities. Therefore, he is like the ocean, always full in himself. Desires may come to him like the waters of the river that flow into the ocean, but he is steady in his activities and he is not even slightly disturbed by desires for sense gratification. That is the proof of a Krishna conscious man, one who has lost all inclinations for material sense gratification. Although the desires are present, because he remains satisfied in the transcendental loving service of the Lord, he can remain steady like the ocean and therefore enjoy full peace. Others, however, who want to fulfill desires even up to the limit of liberation, what to speak of material success, never attain peace. The fruitive workers, the salvationists, and also the yogis who are after mystic powers are all unhappy because of unfulfilled desires. But the person in Krishna consciousness is happy in the service of the Lord and he has no desires to be fulfilled. In fact, he does not even desire liberation from the so-called material bondage. The devotees of Krishna have no material desires and therefore they are in perfect peace.
Yes. So, yeah, I think it's an amazing purport what Prabhupada gives. And, you know, so Krishna is essentially answering, you know, Arjuna, how a person in Krishna consciousness, how he walks, right? Arjuna asks how he sits, how he speaks or how he walks. So this is how he walks means how he behaves or what is his nature, right? So in the previous shloka, you know, Krishna made that distinction how, you know, the introspective sage, you know, his daytime is a nighttime for the materialist. He's completely opposite of the materialist. And now he's saying that he's not even disturbed by the flow of incessant flow of desires that enter the river like rivers into the ocean. So we can understand even for somebody who is spiritually really advanced, right? The mind, it goes through so many thoughts in the day. I think we discussed this in one of the very early classes. Right, that in a day we run through some 60,000 thoughts on an average, right? 40,000-60,000 thoughts on an average, right? But where we choose to focus, that really decides of, you know, or that really matters, or that really kind of tells who you are, what kind of person you are. So, you know, even for a spiritualist or a transcendentalist, there is an incessant flow of desires, just like rivers into the ocean, which is ever being filled. So the ocean is always being filled by water from the rivers, but it's always, it maintains its boundaries. It doesn't, you know, becomes, you know, enters into the land all the time, right? So it is, although it's being constantly filled, but it's still peaceful, right? It is still maintaining its boundaries, and it is peaceful as such, like that. Similarly, you know, the man who's in Krishna consciousness, he's, you know, bombarded with so many desires, but he's able to remain peaceful. Why? Because he's focused you know, the activities of Krishna consciousness, and he's experiencing transcendental pleasure much higher, you know, and therefore he doesn't care about the lower taste. So just like in the previous shloka, I want to throw this question out, and maybe this is something which we also discuss in one of the breakout rooms today. So, you know, we saw the distinction of how, you know, the transcendentalist is completely opposite to the materialist. It's like they're like poles apart, right? Night and day. What is our situation? We are hanging somewhere in between, right? Sometimes we feel, oh, you know, spiritual life is so great. Sometimes we feel, oh, material life is so great, right? I want to do more on the material front, but then we are pulled, oh, I want to do something more on the spiritual front. So our position is somewhere in between, right? You know, and here where Krishna is describing that a person is not disturbed, such a person who's in Krishna consciousness is not disturbed by the incessant flow of desires. But if we look at ourselves, right, and this is the practical application where we need to kind of think, right? Sometimes we can, you know, not be disturbed. But most of the times, we are disturbed by the incessant flow of desires. So what is it that we can do, you know, to achieve this state where, you know, we are not disturbed? Or is this a state that I want to be in? That's question one. Then if I want to be in this state, question number two is, what should I do to be here? Right? We are seeing that, you know, all you know, Prabhupada is describing the devotee is not disturbed by such desires because of his fullness. Right? So Krishna is known as Atma Ram. Atma Ram means Krishna is self-satisfied. He doesn't need anything external to satisfy him. Similarly, devotees of the Lord are also Atmaram, right? Why? Because they are completely satisfied within. They are completely satisfied, you know, through their activities. There is an internal life, literally, which is there for a devotee, which is nothing but his relationship with the Lord, right? Even the smallest possible thing externally happening, the devotee can see the hand of the Lord and how things are very specifically arranged for him by the personal hands of Krishna, right? So when he sees the hand of the Lord in every activity, he feels such transcendental joy and pleasure that he is completely satisfied. He doesn't need a movie to cheer him up, or he doesn't need, you know, some object or an item to, you know, make him happy. He's always, and we experience this. It's not really the objects. It's not really, you know, the things or surroundings, it's more of relationships or the exchange, loving exchanges in the relationship that actually make us happy. Isn't it? Anyone has some other experience? Or, you know, no, Prabhuji, things really make us happy, right? Am I making sense?
Yeah, so, hi, this is Preeti. I just want to share because I had this question on my mind for last couple of days, and I'm happy that we are talking about this. So, you know, while, you know, even we are reading Gita or even when I'm now chanting and I'm trying to be more aware, but sure. The reality is that I desire a lot of things. And when, you know, I work hard for that and I don't get the result which I was expecting, it disappoints me. And now the only thing what I feel, and I don't feel that fullness right now of Krishna consciousness for sure. Because as this says that if you are having that, you will not feel that way. But I do feel. So something happened 2 days back and I was very disappointed. It was work-related situation. I had worked hard, but I didn't get the result which I was expecting for some reason. And yeah, for some time I was in a very sad state of affairs. And I said, why did this happen? And now when you're saying, you see that in everything what is happening to you is happening because of Krishna, you know, so he's kind of leading you. Now, you know, I actually tried this. I told myself that अच्छा जो होता है अच्छे के लिए होता है एंड यू नो भगवान कर रहे हैं ये सब कोई बात नहीं बट ऑनेस्टली आई वॉज ट्राइंग टू चेंज माई सेल्फ टॉक विच वी एक्चुअली साइंटिफिकली से दैट्स हाउ ब्रेन वर्क्स इफ यू यूज दिस इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस टेक्निक बेसिकली वी कॉल दिस ऑल्सो इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस टेक्निक बट आई वॉज सैड फॉर सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम एट सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम एंड देन आई थिंक नेक्स्ट मॉर्निंग आई सेड सी इट्स बियॉन्ड मी आई कांट डू एनीथिंग अबाउट इट सो यू बेटर एक्सेप्टेड हाउ लॉन्ग यू वॉन्ट टू बी सैड अबाउट इट ओके यहां से नहीं हुआ तो लेट्स सी मे बी सम अदर अपॉर्चुनिटी बट this is still on my mind, you know, it's been 2 days now.
Yeah.
And so when we say we seek, I'm full of Krishna consciousness or I see Krishna's hand, I'm not able to feel that from inside. I'm telling myself. And I think there's a difference when you tell yourself or when you experience that. So, and I'm sure you remember that when we started these classes, I said, well, theoretically I understand, but practically I'm yet to experience that. So I'm looking forward to something which will help me to practically experience that feeling of fullness of Krishna. And by the way, I did chant 3 rounds that night when I was very upset. I said, okay, let me chant 3 times. So I slept peacefully, that I must say.
So very, very nice. Thank you for sharing this. So Krishna consciousness is a cultivation, right? It's a practice. And things won't turn around. We won't become pure devotees overnight. So what we are discussing in the purport, Prabhupada is describing of a person who is in Krishna consciousness. He is already full in himself internally. Like I said, we are, you know, in between, or not even, I should not say, you know, you should not consider in between that we are somewhere in the middle. But we've just started our journey practically, right? We're just, you know, we've just turned, you know, in the right direction, and there is a long way to go, right? So yeah, expect, you know, things won't turn around overnight, right? And like you rightly said, you know, it is something which you cannot impose on the mind. It's not an artificial imposition on the mind that, okay,
yeah,
it's not like that. It comes naturally from within, and like I said, slowly and steadily. And I'll just give you one example, which will probably help you clarify and understand what you should do in such situations. So there was this devotee, his great Janmashtami Prabhu. He's, you know, very, very senior devotee. He's one of my Shiksha Gurus and from Mayapur, who taught us Bhakti Shastri. So he gave his own example in one of the sessions which we were attending. So he said that, you know, they used to go out in buses to distribute, Srila Prabhupada's books like Bhagavad Gita and, you know, other books. So every morning they would go out in the bus, and in the bus only, they had a traveling Sankirtan bus. So they would live in the bus, they would do Mangal Arati and all their morning program and Japa inside the bus. It was a huge bus. And then they would, you know, pull out all the books from the trunk, and then they would go out on the street and start distributing those books throughout the day. That was their entire day, literally. And then they would come back and honor some prasadam and sleep, like that. So, and they would be out on the street for, you know, good 8, 10, 12 hours also, trying to distribute books. Right? So, you know, while he was trying to do that... Sorry, someone saying something? Okay, yeah, just please be on mute if you're not wanting to ask something, just for the timing. Yeah. So he was out distributing books, and those first few days when he was there, you know, the books were going like hotcakes, and he was really excited. He would do some 50, 60 books in a day, and he was very, very enthusiastic. One morning, right, there was after the Bhagavatam class, there was, you know, so they would have their morning prasadam. They would have prasadam twice in the day, at 9 o'clock in the morning and then 5 o'clock in the evening. So only 2 times. So 9 o'clock prasadam, he ate, you know, there was some very nice luxurious prasadam that day, some very nice ghee halwa, and he overate, right? And naturally, because of that overeating, he was feeling very sleepy. And obviously he was not very enthusiastic, and he went out to distribute books. And that day, typically he would do, you know, some 50, 60 books or 70 books per day. That day he could only manage 5 books. And he was feeling so sad, right? That, you know, I spoke to so many people, but, you know, they were not taking the books. And I don't know why this is happening to me, you know. And his mind could not get over it. So next morning, you know, he, in the Bhagavatam class, you know, he asked this question, you know, how can I be enthusiastic? Because I was so dull, you know, I was feeling so, you know, sleepy and, you know, so unenthusiastic. You know, nobody bought a book from me. And I was not feeling, you know, motivated to distribute books also. Which means that, you know, the Krishna consciousness was not naturally coming to him. The enthusiasm was not naturally coming to him. So in that situation, what to do? So the devotee replied to him, to be enthusiastic, you have to be enthusiastic. Now, what does that mean? Right. So he clarified, what does that mean? Right. So the devotee said that, fine, Krishna consciousness, because we are so conditioned right now, right? Our soul is covered with tons and tons and layers of past impressions, bad habits, so many other things. So it's not going to go immediately, right? It's not going to be one swoop and it's all gone, right? It'll take its own sweet time, right? And when you start Krishna consciousness, it may feel like, oh, I'm doing this mechanically. I'm not feeling like it, but, you know, I know intelligently that it has to be done, right? Like we were discussing yesterday, sorry, not yesterday, the last class, that Krishna likes people who struggle for him. So this is one of the struggles. The mind is not agreeing. It's saying the opposite, right? But I know through intelligence, by understanding Bhagavad Gita and Krishna's instruction, that, you know, the opposite is supposed to be done. Spirituality is like poles apart. I need to go this direction and not this direction. We understand this intelligently. And if we do this, go on this path, even though mechanically showcasing enthusiasm, Krishna seeing that effort, that, okay, this person's mind is saying the opposite, still he's trying to come towards me and trying to be enthusiastic. So although the process may initially be mechanical, Krishna seeing that effort will bless you with the natural enthusiasm. And that's what happened with this devotee. So he understood that, okay, I need to, you know, even though I'm not feeling natural enthusiasm, I need to be enthusiastic. So he went out on the street that day, you know, very, very cheerful, full of enthusiasm, right? Showcasing enthusiasm, although he was not internally feeling that. But he told his mind that, yes, this is service of Krishna, I need to be enthusiastic. And he behaved in a very enthusiastic way. And within no time, you know, the books went left, right, and center. And within 20 minutes, naturally, he was so inspired and enthusiastic, right? That the entire day was like very, very amazing for him, right? So we have to put that initial effort, right? You know, zang lag gaya, thoda sa humko dhakka marna padega, right? To get the rust off. And then the, you know, and oil it also more. So the natural oil Krishna will supply, and, you know, the machine will run, or the natural enthusiasm will come. So our situation is like that. We are hanging in between, right? We are not fully fulfilled internally. We are not completely fulfilled. But yes, we understand that this is the right process, this is the right path. Slowly and steadily, I need to progress, right? Like you said, you chanted 3 rounds and at least you could sleep peacefully. You know, something like this happens, you know, even I sometimes I'm not able to sleep also nicely because I think constantly keep thinking, you know, how can I change the situation? How, why this happened, etc., etc. But then we understand that, yes, oh, at the end of the day, you know, it's Krishna, results is in Krishna's hands, right? And whatever he desires, fine. Let me at least sleep right now and let me then put my best effort from tomorrow morning. Right? So do your best. Leave the rest, right? So the more you apply, right, our brains are hardwired for, you know, thinking, you know, the way the mind wants in a negative way. It is hardwired to bring us down, right? Because for so many lifetimes our practice has been sense gratification, our practice has been not Krishna consciousness. So it takes some practice, some effort, right? And then after that it will become natural. So devote, similarly, actually, this is a very important verse, even for relationships, right? the husband, right, he's supposed to be, so I was hearing this, this devotee was talking about relationships in this connection. He was describing how, when there are two people, husband and wife, right, they need to, and when they have a life centered around Krishna consciousness, right, when their hearts are, satisfied or fulfilled to at least some degree with Krishna consciousness, the conflicts are less. Otherwise, it's just demanding from the other person, oh, you fulfill my desires, expectations, and therefore anger, and therefore conflicts, right? How could you not do this, what I ask you or what I expect you to do, right? There is always this, demand. Why? You are depending completely on the other person for your enjoyment. That is where the root cause of all problems start in relationships, right? You're expecting enjoyment or satisfaction from the other person, right? Whereas in case of somebody who, grihastha life or any relationship for that matter, which is centered around Krishna, right? Our hearts are fulfilled by serving the Lord, right? That want or greed for happiness is being satisfied by serving the Lord. And therefore, we can deal with the relationship without having, extravagant expectations. So this inner fulfillment will come slowly and steadily, not that overnight will happen because you're not fully Krishna conscious. But we know this is the right path. It will take some time and effort, maybe this lifetime, right? Not that it will happen in a year, but it depending on how seriously, how sincerely you practice the process, it can happen very quickly. It can happen over a lifetime. It can happen over 10 lifetimes. Depends on how we practice. I hope gave you some sort of answer, or did it confuse you more?
No. I think I understood what you said. Thanks for that.
Yeah. Okay. Any other thoughts, Prabhuji? You want to add something?
No, Prabhuji, one point only, but very beautifully explained, Prabhuji, from all aspects, covered everything. So the point is in the application. That is just what I wanted to add. Prabhuji also mentioned that. So theoretically, we know a lot. When we apply it, then we'll be able to see the results also. So like Prabhuji was mentioning earlier about accepting things favorable, rejecting things favorable. And so when we start applying those principles in our life, then we'll be able to see the result, practically. And even no one will have to, come from outside and tell you that you are happy and you are satisfied within. You will feel it yourself. In as much as a person is, fully satisfied by, when he's had a full meal, in that capacity, you'll actually be able to see that, yes, I'm also fully satisfied in Krishna consciousness. So it's the application of all the teachings.
And it is such a science. Our acharyas have given almost like scientists or people who are strategists, right? So spiritual scientists or spiritual strategists, they've given an outline so perfect that there is check and balance at every point. Right? On a very broad level, I think I've discussed this earlier also, on a very broad level, there are 9 stages of levels, right? Adav, Shuddha, Tata, Sadhu, Sam, Bhajana, Kriya, Anartha, Nidhita, Ruchi, Asakti, Bhavan, Prem. Right? If I understand that nishtha is not coming, firm determination is not coming, the previous step is a problem. Anartha nivritti has not happened correctly and therefore nishtha is not coming. Anartha nivritti means all the misgivings in the heart, all the bad habits, all the lust, greed, anger, etc. in the heart is still there, right? If anartha nivritti is not happening, I identify, I have so many anarthas. The previous step, bhajan kriya, is not happening correctly, which means I'm not chanting properly, I'm not associating properly, not reading scriptures enough, right? So bhajan kriya is a issue. If bhajan kriya, you identify it's not happening, I'm not feeling enthusiastic in bhajan kriya, I'm not feeling enthusiastic in chanting or even kirtans for that matter, right? Or, I don't feel enthusiastic, attending the class every Saturday, right? Which means sadhu sangha is a problem. Previous.
Yes. Prabhuji, can I share something?
Yes.
If it's okay for a minute. There is something very strange, and I thought maybe I'll just share this. So I think we started these sessions from January, right? Somewhere, I think, mid of January. Correct. So it's almost now 5-6 months. So I think at the very beginning, I think you had, there was a chapter where Sri Prabhupada, I think you explained and said that in whatever you do, actions or words or whatever, always keep in mind, what is it something which takes you, what is it that will take me closer to Krishna and what is it will not? So I just wanted to share an experience. I think every time I do anything, I talk anything, I speak words, there is always something which I've started comparing, you know, oh no, this will take me, this will not. I think that has really helped in a very long way, very, very long way till date. So it's like application of, you know what, so I thought I'll just share it with you.
Thank you so much for sharing this.
It has really helped in every action, every word you speak. I'm not saying, of course, we do certain things which are wrong. We may talk, we may hurt somebody or whatever. But I think at least that attempt is there of thinking, oh, is it right? So I think somewhere maybe 20% we have progressed.
Excellent. Yes. And that's the effort. And that's when we are conscious. So again, you know, when Bhajan Kriya is happening nicely, or when Sadhu Sangha is happening nicely, when you're hearing, you're remembering these small points.
Right. Yeah, very true.
So that is where, you know, when you apply this, the next stage, which is anartha nivritti, starts happening, right?
No, you're completely conscious all the time, at least, rather than not being in a conscious state.
Yeah. Excellent. I'm so happy that, you know, somewhere.
No, that thing had always caught me like.
That's very nice. So this is exactly what Anukulena Krishna, Anukulesa Sankalpa, Pratikulasya Varjuna, right? We accept the favorable. We know, okay, this will take me towards Krishna. Let me do it. And we reject the unfavorable. This will take me away from Krishna.
So, yeah, sorry. Connecting to, I think, what Sujata shared and what you're sharing, I'm just trying to apply now. Mm-hmm. So when, let's say, my desire is not fulfilled and I'm disappointed in that moment. Mm-hmm. And if I ask myself, what will bring me closer to Krishna in this? Should I ask this question in that moment when my desire is not fulfilled and I'm disappointed? Or like I said, I chanted 3 rounds. Okay, that's something which came to my mind. Okay, let me chant. I didn't have this question, what should I do to bring me closer? My question was, what can make me feel a little better? Because I'm very disappointed. So what in that moment, and I'm specifically asking about this because this is something which disturbs me. When I'm not getting what I want, I'm disturbed. So in that moment, what is the practical application which will help me to become more Krishna conscious?
Yeah, if you specifically ask what will make you more Krishna conscious, right? If that is the question versus, you know, what will make me peaceful or what will, you know, take my mind off from there. You know, these are two different questions. So what will make you more Krishna conscious is the cultivation, like I said. Krishna consciousness is the cultivation.
What we do every day, right? Like, for example, chanting, reading.
I'll do one of my own personal examples. Ideally, I should not, but you know, since this is relevant. So I was actually, this was almost like 5-6 years back. So I had, first of all, okay, there's a long story, but I'll try to cut it short. So I was supposed to join, Wipro in Bangalore, for example. I was shifting my job and I was, you know, trying to get into, a better position. And I actually got, you know, the position, the money, etc., which Wipro was offering me in Bangalore. But then, you know, there was such an attachment, or I should not say such an, but some attachment at least, to Sri Sri Radha Ras Vihari in Juhu. So I somehow the other, you know, it was eating me inside that, you know, how can I leave and go to, you know, another city? And because although Krishna will be there, but Radha Ras Vihari is not there, right? So it's praying, and somehow the other, the Lord arranged in such a way that within a matter of a day, one day literally, I was supposed to next day fly, and they had prepared everything. I mean, although it was terrible for me to ditch them, but yeah, they had prepared everything. And I was supposed to just take a flight, land there, and, you know, my rooms were booked and, everything was organized. But I did not take that flight because on that same day where I prayed to the Lord, another company called me saying that we have a job for you. You know, you have to just travel to Singapore for a month or two and then you can stay in Bombay, etc. and, you know, lead a team there. And in a matter of, and I told them the situation, and in a matter of a day's time, you know, one day, they did everything, my background check, all my papers, everything in just that few hours. And by night, I had the offer letter and I could, you know, decide, okay, I'm going to stick here. So in that same job, you know, one of my first projects, so it was a big presentation to, you know, one of the top persons at Mahindra, you know, almost like, you know, second or third in line to Mr. Anand Mahindra. So very, very big presentation. So, you know, I was really, really stressed about it. And I was trying to focus, trying to ask around so many people in my circle who are trying to do a similar kind of work, you know, because it was just a week or so and I had to prepare like a big presentation. I was struggling. I was trying to think hard and even more hard. How do I do this? And I could manage just 3 slides or 4 slides, right? And I really, it was not clicking. It couldn't crack, you know, and those were the days where Ram Navami was also going on. So one of my very dear friends, Apurva Gopal Prabhu, he invited me. He, why don't you do some seva? And I was asking him also, he's also in a very similar kind of field as a consultant. So he was also, you know, I was asking him as well for suggestions. He gave me some suggestions, but you know, nothing was working because it was not clicking. So then he invited me, you know, forget this for some time, just come and do some seva. So I actually went to the temple and it was, you know, I think Ram Navami, and I just, you know, prayed to the Lord and I thought, let me just dump this, you know, constant. I was not able to sleep for so many nights because I was constantly thinking, in a week's time, I have this presentation. I was literally, you know, getting on my nerves. Then I simply in the temple dumped the idea, okay, let me for the next 2 hours not think at all and just be absorbed. And I started seva, and in practically no time, I was absorbed there. It was not that I had to force my mind to, you know, absorb myself somewhere. I was naturally absorbed, right? And believe me, the minute I finished that seva, the kind of ideas that poured into my head, I simply ran to my laptop. In half an hour, I put together a 102-slider presentation, which was later, you know, very well received on the other end. So, and therefore we stress, right? Not that, you know, for these miracles, but therefore we stress. If you want to absorb your mind, sometimes, you know, chanting or sometimes just intellectualizing things may not work. We need to physically engage in some services. When your senses are engaged somewhere, right, your mind will be there, right? When you put all your senses in particular service, right? And especially when, you know, so you're serving Krishna, there is a certain taste, right? There is certain absorption that will come slowly and steadily. When you're absorbed there, your mind will be off from, you know, the overall situation. And then you'll be out of that and you'll be able to see it from a broader perspective that, okay, you know, this happened, it's okay, but then, you know, maybe I could do this 1, 2, 3, 4 things and fix it. When your mind is, you know, when your consciousness is raised to a level where you can see the problem from top, right, then you can easily solve it. Otherwise, you'll be constantly there thinking, how will I surmount these skyscrapers? How will I get over this? And your mind won't let you get out of this thought process or this conversation. How can I get out, right? Or why did this happen to me? Like that. So you need to absorb yourself. If chanting is not working immediately for you, of course it will work. But along with chanting, engage yourself in some service, because that is also, sometimes we need something intellectual. Sometimes we need something physical, right? So yena kena prakarena, somehow or the other, if we engage ourselves in some service, which is very, very absorbing, your mind will be out of it. Is that okay? Prabhuji,
yes, yes.
Parthapriya Prabhu, anything you want to add?
No, Prabhuji, just perfect. Practical service, and that is why, when we'll realize how it makes the difference.
I think Prabhuji only was giving a class yesterday, and he was describing, you know, in fact, in the second chapter also, we, you know, we understood how lust is our biggest enemy. Right, and how to control lust, you know, there are sitting places of the lust. It sits in the in the senses, it sits in our mind and intelligence. And to control the mind and intelligence immediately is very difficult. But we have control over our senses, that is slightly more easier to control, right? So we should at least arrange in a way that our senses are engaged. So if I know, you know, that I won't be, you know, if some nice delicious food is brought in front of me, which is not good for me, I won't be able to control my mind and senses. But I still have control. I can run away from the place. So that immediate control over the senses is still there, right? And through some intelligence, which is a little bit more powerful at that point in time, I can decide that let me walk away immediately. Otherwise, I'll be forced into eating this because my mind won't be able to control. So let me, I have this at least some control right now over my senses. Let me use those, you know, have my legs and hands activated. Let me leave the place like that. And that's what Ajamil failed to do, right? When he was, you know, going in the forest and he saw that sight. And instead of running away from the place, which he could have done, he actually waited. And, you know, he was trying to chant things in his head, still standing there, still looking, right? Which led to his fall down. So it's difficult, more difficult to control the mind at that point in time. But senses are immediately under our power. So if you engage the senses, you can be out of the situation more easily. Okay. So we covered this, right? So 71. Okay, let's do the next two shlokas real quickly and then we'll get into a breakout room. Vihaya kamanyah sarvan.
Vihaya kamanyah sarvan.
Umamscharati nispriha.
Umamscharati nispriha.
Nirmamo nirankara.
Nirmamo nirankara.
Ashantim adigacchati.
Ashantim adigacchati.
Yes, anyone would like to read the translation? Just the translation.
Yes, I'll read, Prabhuji. A person who has given up all desires for sense gratification, who lives free from desires, who has given up all sense of proprietorship and is devoid of false ego, he alone can attain real peace.
A person who has given up, so Krishna is further explaining the qualities of a devotee. He's describing a person who's given up all desires for sense gratification, lives free from desires, right? Not that there are no desires, right? But there are no material desires. That's the meaning of free from desires. Who has given up all sense of proprietorship and is devoid of false ego, he alone can attain real peace. So again, we can understand, you know, false ego is the last thing to go. It's literally the last thing to go, right? And therefore, you know, here at this point, what Krishna is talking about is a self-realized devotee who's devoid of false ego. False ego means I am so-and-so. I am a doctor. I'm a lawyer. You know, I'm son of such and such person. I'm a, you know, PhD or something. So these are all bodily designations, right? Sarvopadi vinirmuktam tatparetvena nirmalam rishikena rishikesham sevana bhakti. Uttam bhakti means sarvopadi vinirmuktam, one who's free from all, from sense of proprietorship and sense of, you know, all kinds of upadhis. Upadhis means titles. That is the false ego. We give ourselves so many titles. So somebody who is devoid of all kind of different titles and this and that, right? But has real ego. What is real ego? We still have a title, but real title. What is the real title? I am servant of God. Jivera Swarup Hoy Krishnaya Nityadas. When we realize that I am not none of these other things, but I am actually a servant of God. That is a real ego. That is a real ego means identity. So we have real identity, which is we are servants of God, and we have false ego. Oh, I'm actually Mr. X. I'm, you know, I have so many different degrees, and you know, I'm owner of this house, I'm, you know, father of these children, etc. These are all different upadhis or titles. So to become desireless means not to desire any sense gratification. In other words, desire for becoming Krishna conscious is actual desirelessness. Right? To understand one's actual position as eternal servitor of Krishna without falsely claiming this material body to be oneself and without falsely claiming proprietorship over anything in the world is perfect stage of Krishna consciousness. one who is situated in this perfect state knows that because Krishna is proprietor of everything, everything must be used for satisfaction of Krishna. Right? So when you know that you're a servant, you behave like a servant. Right? So everything that you get belongs to the master and you naturally offer it to the master. So Arjuna did not want to fight for his own sense satisfaction. But when he became fully Krishna conscious, he fought because Krishna wanted him to fight. For himself, there was no desire to fight. But for Krishna, the same Arjuna fought to his best ability. Real desirelessness is desire for satisfaction of Krishna and not an artificial attempt to abolish desires. Right? So when we desire, oh, I want this, you know, this project, or, you know, I want to, you know, get this, you know, get whatever I want to achieve for Krishna. Right? That is real desirelessness, not an artificial imposition on the mind that, oh, I should be desireless or I should not care about it, I should not be affected. No, you will be affected. But when Krishna comes in center, the more and more Krishna comes in center, right? That, oh, I am a servant, belongs to Krishna, the results belong to Krishna, you know, the overall things actually is Krishna's, right? Then we become peaceful. The living entity cannot be desireless or senseless, but he does not have to change the quality of desire. But he does have to change the quality of desire. Just the shift. Instead of desiring for myself, I desire for Krishna. A materially desireless person certainly knows that everything belongs to Krishna. Ishavasyam idam sarvam. And therefore, he does not falsely claim proprietorship over everything. This transcendental knowledge is based on self-realization, namely, knowing perfectly well that every living entity is an eternal part and parcel of Krishna and spiritual identity, and that eternal position of living entity is therefore never on the level of Krishna or greater than him. This understanding of Krishna consciousness is the basic principle of real peace. Again, the peace formula. Right? So we are moving a little fast. It's already 12:30. So last shloka. So Krishna has till this point described, now he's concluding literally the entire chapter. Esha Brahmi Sita Partha.
Esha Brahmi Sthita Partha.
Nainam Prapya Vimuyati.
Nainam Prapya Vimuyati.
Tavasyam Antakalepi.
Tavasyam Antakalepi.
Brahma Nirvanam Ritchati.
Brahma Nirvanam Ritchati.
Very, very interesting shloka. Please read the translation, someone.
Yeah, I will read. This is the way of spiritual and godly life, after attaining which a man is not bewildered. If one is thus situated, even of death, one can enter into the kingdom of God.
So, very important and very hope-giving, right? That this is the way of spiritual and godly life, after attaining which a man is not bewildered. Fine. If one is thus situated, even at the hour of death, one can enter into the kingdom of God. So, even at, and Prabhupada, you know, there's a audio recording of his class in this. So, Prabhupada is describing, even at the last moment, someone accepts Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, surrenders unto him, right? And identifies himself as his servant, he is eligible to go back home, back to Godhead. So whatever we describe in the previous shlokas, whatever Krishna described the qualities of a devotee, if one can be situated in that, even at the last moment, right, in Krishna consciousness, even at the last moment, one can enter into the kingdom of God, right? So obviously somebody would have had to practice it throughout his life, and then one can think of the Lord in the last moment. But nonetheless, even if somebody is not, you know, so elevated or advanced, but he's struggled for Krishna throughout his life, right? Even at the last moment, Krishna can shower that, you know, ocean of mercy, and one can immediately rise to the platform of complete Krishna consciousness and enter into the kingdom of God. If somebody just even at the last moment accepts, yes, Krishna, I surrender unto you completely, right? I'm yours, right? Immediately one can enter the kingdom of God. Right? That is the beauty of Krishna consciousness. So Prabhupada here in the purport, he gives the example of Khatvang Maharaj. Right? Khatvang Maharaj was a very, very powerful king. Right? So powerful that even the demigods used to take his help to fight the asuras. And he was extremely, extremely powerful. So once he was, in the heavens, fighting against the demons for the demigods, right? And the battle went for very, very long, and Khatwang Maharaj fought very, very valiantly, and killed most of the demons, and the others ran away. And the demigods were very, very pleased, with the entire effort of Khatwang Maharaj, and they said, please ask us for a boon. So Khatwang Maharaj, he asked, okay, tell me how much time is left for me, since he was in the higher planets. So according to earthly calculation, one day in the higher planets is 6 months here. So a lot of time had been passed fighting. So he asked, okay, how much more time is left? So they said, oh, there's only one moment left. So immediately Khatwang Maharaj, he came down and utilized that time to focus his mind completely on the Lord, and left his body thinking of the Lord, and entered in the spiritual sky, back to God. So we can understand from this example that even in the last moment, if one can be thus situated in Krishna consciousness, fully surrendering himself, he's eligible to enter the spiritual kingdom, right? So I think we'll read just portions of it, since it's 12:30 already. And it's not a very big one, but Prabhupada, he described that actual life begins after the completion of this material life. For gross materialist, it is sufficient to know that one has to end this life materialistic way, But for person who are spiritually advanced, there is another life after this materialistic life. So before ending this life, if one is fortunate to become Krishna conscious, he at once attains the stage of Brahman Nirvana. So he's describing what is Brahman Nirvana. And according to Buddhist philosophy, they say it's void, etc. Nirvana means, there is nothing after completion of the material life, etc. But we understand that there is an entire spiritual kingdom. Or, if you're not completely perfect, you'll take birth again. So everything doesn't end with the end of the body, right? There's a continuation like that. And then, attainment of Krishna consciousness, even during this life, is in immediate attainment of Brahman. So someone can actually, while living only, be Jivan Mukta, right? Not that you only have to die to become fully Krishna conscious, right? You can actually practice and become fully Krishna conscious even in this life, right? And all your activities are completely spiritualized. Therefore, we say spiritual master's body is transcendental. It's not material. Why? Because 100% he is using his body, mind, and words in service of the Lord. Therefore, his body is transcendental. So they are Jivan Mukta, they are liberated while living. So if one is practicing Krishna consciousness seriously, even in this life, while living, one can be in the stage of Brahman Nirvana or Jivan Mukta for that matter. Right? And it's just a transition. When he has to give up his body, he still continues the same service in the spiritual kingdom or anywhere else as the Lord desires. Right? Okay, Brahman is just the opposite of matter. Therefore, Brahmi Stiti means not on the platform of material activities. So it's on the spiritual plane and not on the material plane. Devotional service of the Lord is accepted in Bhagavad Gita as liberated stage. Sarguna Samatitan Brahma Bhuyaya Kalpati. Therefore, Brahma Stiti is liberation from material bondage. Right. So again, we discussed the definition of Mukti. Mukti means being situated in your constitutional position. What is a constitutional position? That we are servants of the Lord. It doesn't just mean that, oh, when I die, I merge into the Lord. Merging again, like we discussed, never happens. But Mukti really means being sthita, or situated in your swarupa, that I am the servant of the Lord. And even now, right now, if you, develop, cultivate that consciousness, and while living, you are in that situation that, okay, I am the servant of the Lord, then you are Jivan Mukta, like I was describing earlier. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur has summarized the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita as being contents of the whole text, right? So second chapter is like overview or summary of the entire Bhagavad Gita. The subject matters are karma, yoga, jnana yoga, bhakti yoga. In the second chapter, karma yoga and jnana yoga have been clearly discussed, and the glimpse of bhakti yoga has also been given as the contents of the complete text. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport up to the second chapter of Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the matter of its contents. So we will stop the discussion here. 10 minutes, we can get into breakout rooms for 5 minutes. And the question is, we are not pure devotees yet, right? So there is attraction towards doing material things. And there is some sort of attraction now that we're hearing Bhagavad Gita to do some spiritual activities also. How do we balance this? Right? And like I think we discussed quite a bit in, you know, right in the beginning, right? What should we do? How do we practically apply these teachings of Bhagavad Gita and move towards the path of spirituality slowly and steadily? Is the question clear?
Can you please repeat?
Yeah. So the question is, one is that we are not completely pure devotees, right? We have some material attraction to do certain material things, right? And we are affected by that. There is some spiritual attraction also. So right now that we are in between, you know, how should we approach life? What should we do, right? And how do we continue on the path of Krishna consciousness? This is the whole, what is the practical application? What should I do? Like Preeti was asking, you know, what should we do practically, right? When we are in such situations, we want material stuff also. We are affected by it. At the same time, we understand Krishna consciousness. We know the philosophy. We are trying to apply it, but you know, it's not working fully because we are not completely satisfied internally because we are not filled with Krishna consciousness. So how do we deal with the situation currently at hand? How do we apply these teachings in our day-to-day life? What should be the attitude and approach and practical application? Is that okay or
to continue? Aranda.
Yeah, okay.
Let's quickly get into breakout rooms. Prabhuji?
I've created 3 rooms, Prabhuji.
Okay. We are 23. Maybe some more rooms, 4 rooms.
Okay, I already. So there are like 6 or 7 in each of them.
Yeah, I mean, people may not get opportunity to speak now. So rooms. Limited time.
So room 2 and 3, one of us can join each of them.
Join 3.
Room 2 and 3. Which one, Pruji, you like to go?
I'm joining 3.
Okay, I'll go to 2 then.
Hello.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Chinmay, Kavita and Alka. Okay. So it says Ulka. You. Is it Ulka or Alka? Your name on the screen appears ULKA.
Hello. This is Ulka. Ulka. Oh, Ulka. Hello. Ulka, yeah. This is.
Yes.
Yeah.
Great. So, can everyone come on cameras if it's okay, if you're not too shy? At least we can, you know, have some face-to-face interaction. Great. Thank you, Kavita. So, yeah, you understood the question. Okay, what are your thoughts? How would you practically apply now that we are not pure devotees and we are still having some material attractions, or, you know, we want to do so many things, achieve so many things materially. So how do we apply this philosophy of Krishna consciousness, what we just heard? How we remain unaffected? How can we get there? Yes, Kavita, you want to start?
By doing chanting only, I feel, and reading now what the book which you have sent is really affecting. Means I started reading. Introduction is done. So somehow the books are also helping.
Okay, so you're saying that the more and more you read, the more you will be pushed towards the path of spirituality and you can apply the philosophy regularly, right? Okay, great. Any other thoughts? Chinmay, how will you apply the philosophy? We read, you know, what are the qualities of pure devotees? How do you plan to get there? So that we are also internally completely satisfied and unaffected. Right now, we are not. Right now, we have so many material things to do as well. So how do you plan to get there?
Yes. So in chanting group, I am in Yudhishthira group. So in there, nowadays we are reading that Perfect Questions, Perfect Answer book.
Okay.
That is very knowledgeable. And it has many morals in each chapter.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to do that. And
sure. So you're learning something because of regularly hearing. So how often do you hear?
Every Tuesday we do.
Every Tuesday, okay. And who's taking the sessions now?
Vidhi Mataji and Priya Mataji only.
Okay, nice.
I'm not able to join that. Actually, I used to, but nowadays I'm not able to join.
No worries. Okay. How's your daughter, Mataji?
She's fine now. She's fine.
Great. Yes. Krishna Agarwal Prabhu, Reshma Mataji, and Ulka Mataji.
Hello, I'm Ulka here.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, actually speaking, I have recently joined. Mm-hmm. Sunday session is the first session of mine.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah, but to remain in Krishna's consciousness, I will be try to remain in awareness, I think. Mm. Awareness when what I speak, what I do means, some little control over my senses and...
So where from that control, how will you be able to stay in that awareness? What should you do practically so that you are in that awareness consciousness? Do you need to adjust something? Do you need to...
Yeah, before talking to anyone, I will have to be conscious what I'm talking next. Yeah. And if I realize that I have something wrong, I have spoken.
Hmm.
Yeah. So I have to rethink over it. Ki what made me to talk like this? What made me to behave like this? Yeah.
Nice. Okay. Okay. So just to add to what you just said, so the mind... Right, mind, most of the time it overpowers the intelligence. Intelligently, we know that, okay, what I spoke is wrong, or, you know, what I'm thinking is wrong. But the mind overpowers most of the times. So to strengthen the mind, the intelligence, there's always a war between the mind and intelligence. So for intelligence to win and for you to be conscious that, okay, what I'm speaking, I should be conscious. Right, you have to make the intelligence win. And for that, you need to strengthen the intelligence. And the way you strengthen the intelligence is by, what is the food for intelligence?
Knowledge.
Any knowledge? Ulka, what is the food for intelligence?
As of now, reading is, I think, that food for intelligence. Yes. Reading good books.
Spiritual knowledge is food.
Spiritual knowledge, yeah. Spiritual
the more, knowledge. More you remind yourself through spiritual knowledge.
Yeah.
When the time comes for application, when you're in a sticky situation, there is an argument going on.
Yeah.
That is a time when, you know, if you've, you know, dedicatedly, regularly read or heard spiritual knowledge, that is a time when it will actually come. You'll be conscious and you'll be able to apply. We need constant reminders. Otherwise, we cannot apply.
Yeah.
Matter how many things you hear, right?
Yeah.
If there is not a constant dedicated practice of hearing and reading, spiritual knowledge, you won't be able to apply it very easily.
Yeah.
I would like
application is very much needed over here. Not just the reading, application is also needed.
Yes. Yeah. You're on mute, Kavita.
I would like to add something. Previously, I never used, sometimes I used to bunk meditation in the morning, but I never used to do the mala. But right now, if I'm not able to join, but I'm trying to finish my 5 mala. So that is a plus point. Like I'm training my mind like to do that. Because I feel ki ek din nahi kiya, to I have, means whatever is done is gone. So I started doing the regularly now. If I'm not joining, but still I'm doing my malas.
Yes.
Could anyone tell me what is about this mala?
So this is the
chanting. It is a jap something.
Yes, this is chanting of Hare Krishna Mahamantra. We have every morning, 6 o'clock, Partha Priya Prabhu, who is also there in the class, he's leading that session. So every morning we get together for 45 minutes. On a Zoom call or a Google Meet call. Together we chant Hare Krishna Mahamantra.
Okay.
So association of devotees becomes very easy to chant regularly on a daily basis. So you're most welcome to join that.
Okay.
And you can probably, put your number in the chat so that we can add you to that mailing list, and every morning you'll be able to join the sessions where you can from I think 6:15 to 7 o'clock we do. So you can also join us and chant Hare Krishna mantra. So 4 or 5 rounds we do in the morning, you can just chant as well.
Okay.
Yes, Reshma and Reshma Madhuji, are you there?
Yes. Actually, for me also, I am very new because the last week was my, I attended it first time. Okay. For me, so like in my view, for me, how would I apply this? Mm-hmm. I first like to know about him because in general, we know everybody, like everybody knows Krishna, how he is. And but I want to know him through what is his teachings and what he has given to us. And I would like to know him, and then I would like to follow his path, like as much as I can.
Excellent.
That is my view about it.
Excellent. So yes, the first step of and that's the purpose of dharma, right? To know God and to love him. So if you want to love someone, you have to first know the person. So so we have to cultivate our covered love. We already, Krishna consciousness or love for God is already there in the heart. It just needs to be uncovered. So this uncovering happens by trying to understand Krishna more and more through Bhagavad Gita, through Bhagavatam. Yes. So that's the perfect way. Thank you so much for sharing. Yes.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Yes, Krishna Garwal Prabhu.
Prabhuji, I'm chanting now 5 rounds in the morning. And I'm gradually increasing one at a time. So Prabhuji told me that you can also chant after in the evening.
Yes.
So yesterday I tried, I did 3 rounds in the morning and 2 in the evening. So today I feel now onwards I can do more rounds and gradually increase.
Yeah.
So that it can go to 16 rounds.
That's so nice. Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
And also I am reading this book reading session at 3 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And on Sundays I also read... Read this storybook of Jagannath book.
Yes.
With my son and grandson. The grandson is, he started with one paragraph, but now he is finding interest in story reading, and so he's reading more.
Very nice. So, yeah, that's how you should engage children also. So nice. Yeah. Thank you, David. So there is someone, Bittu, I think there's some. Bittu Mataji, are you there? I can see the name Bittu. Hare Krishna? Bittu Mataji, are you there? Okay. All right. I think let's get back to the main group. So everyone can leave the room. There's a leave room button. So there you say leave breakout room. Don't end the meeting for all. Just say leave breakout room. Right. So you'll be back in the main group.
What we already discussed was that accepting everything and rejecting everything favorable to accept and rejecting everything unfavorable, which we already learned today. And then we discussed the point how to simply leave it to Krishna. So this point was made by Pallavi Mataji.
Simply what?
Leave it to Krishna, surrender.
Okay.
So when there's a point of balance and we don't know how to really do it, then relying more on the spiritual aspect, it will itself take care of the material aspect, was the point that we discussed. Then was that we should not see the two things different, because Srila Prabhupada says that we have to include Krishna in everything. So even whatever material we are doing, including it in everything that we are doing, is actually spiritual. So this was the point that we also discussed. And one more point that Narayani Mataji discussed was even elaborating on surrender is how to continue our Krishna conscious activities, serving prasadam and chanting. So yes, these were the points that we discussed.
Nice. So yeah, I think the point of prasadam is very, very critical also. So this is one of the things which are extremely favorable in Krishna consciousness, is actually offering food to Krishna and taking prasad. Yes, Chinmay, you can paste the points. Right? So something practical, something we do on a daily basis, and so much of our consciousness is dependent on what we eat. In fact, most of the ladies, most of their consciousness also goes in what to cook, right? It's one of the, our culture is actually, our religion is kitchen religion, right? Okay. So we should also, stress on cooking for the pleasure of the Lord, offering it to Krishna, and then serving our family members also with Krishna prasad. So just by this simple act, you can actually change a person completely, right? Somebody who's been the most unfavorable will turn favorable suddenly. If you regularly feed that person Krishna prasad. So yeah, it's very, very powerful, very important point. One of the practical things we can apply today. So thank you, whosoever brought that point. Yes. And you should reject the unfavorable, which means that reject, or try to not have food which is, cannot be offered to the Lord, like onion, garlic, or, meat, of course, the non-vegetarian food. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam. So you can offer me a leaf, fruit, flower, water, things like that. So try as much as possible, and this is one of the main things, your association and, food. These are the two main things that affect your consciousness. Yes, so great points. Anyone else would like to share what they discuss in the breakout room? Any other pointers? How will we apply what we learned today in our day-to-day life? Chinmay has already given. A sage will get up early in the morning before sunrise, while a lazy man will get up late. Man who's not disturbed by materialistic desires can accomplish very easily. You must simply desire about Krishna. Yes, excellent. All right. So any other points? Quickly, in a minute. It's already 12:58. Partha Priya Prabhu, are you there?
Yes, Suji.
So any discussions from your group that you remember?
Yeah, lot of discussions, different points. Okay, be consistent, don't expect. Yes, Priyanka Mataji said that in the group, that we need to be, so her point was that her perspective to life has changed. So no matter what she's doing now, it was a very deep point. She said that she doesn't expect, any great results. She leaves it to Krishna. And she knows one thing, that whatever is going to happen is going to be for her good, favorable for her practices. So that is a very nice point. Preeti Mataji also shared wonderful points. She spoke about how she has understood that the practice of Krishna consciousness can, give us a higher taste, with which we can then give up lower taste, and the taste for sense enjoyment will become very insignificant. So this is what she's understood.
Just a point there. It is our responsibility to develop that taste. Not that, someone will come and give it to us. It is our responsibility. So we need to practice it seriously, and also keep checking, where am I going wrong, right? So that you practice correctly, and thereby you get the results. Because our acharyas have already gone through this. They've given us the path, the check and balance, like I was saying. Yeah. Yes, Prabhuji, continue, please. Sorry.
Yeah, and some of the other points were not to be distracted by material things and trying to remain focused on our practices. And there was another point which said that we should not be indulging in sense gratification at all. We should be very careful and control ourselves. Mm. And we also spoke of how it's difficult to control ourselves when the sense object is right in front of us. So instead of, you know, always trying to run away from it, better is to engage ourselves positively,
correct,
you know, in Krishna consciousness. Then it becomes easy to give up anything. If we just try to run away from something which is attracting us, it's difficult. Mm. But if we are positively engaged, then it becomes easy.
Perfect.
Any other points if I've missed, please do add from the group. There were quite a few other points. I just picked up a few.
Any other points anyone would want to mention? Subramanyam Prabhu or Rinku Mataji or Priyanka or Shantala Mataji?
Yes, we have to be grateful for every little thing. Even every moment is a moment that we have to thank God to remember Him. And at the end of the day, when we have to just analyze what good things have happened and what we have not achieved, so we wait for the right time to happen. That's it.
Yeah, I also said that, you know, we have to be moving towards more and more of the Lord so that He gives us the strength to get away from the materialistic pleasures, you know, and take Him towards Him. So prayers will definitely help. Yes.
Prayers, engaging ourselves. Okay, so I think we end the class here. Thank you, everyone. It's already 1 o'clock. So... we're over time. So thank you so much for patiently listening and being around.
Thank you.
We meet next week. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Thank you.